Okay, so we can begin. I'm informing you that this session is being recorded and we'll be uploading it. Okay, and today we'll be talking about Julius Caesar, the play by Shakespeare, and Act 4 and Act 5. These are the two acts that we will be discussing. Now, in the previous act, that is Act 3, I hope you remember that we called it the climax of this five-act play. And yeah, it was the climax of this five-act play in the sense that, you know, it was the peak of action. Understand, all the events of Act 1 and Act 2 were leading up to this moment, and it was the pivotal moment, it was a pivotal act upon which, you know, the crux of the play rested. And from now on, all the actions are consequential or a result of whatever transpired in Act 3. Okay, now in Act 4, you have a new triumvirate, a second triumvirate that has been formed with Antony, Octavius, and Lepidus. Okay, that's another soldier by the name of Lepidus. He was a general. Okay, and you know, these three men have been talking about how, who are the people who should be allowed to live and who are the people who should be killed. Understand? Because, you know, when you, you know, kind of overthrow an existing regime, and when you, you know, kind of start a coup, and what you have to do is that, you know, there are a lot of people that, you know, you eliminate because you consider them dangerous, okay, to your cause. You may think of them as disloyal, and some people just do it out of, you know, plain peevishness. But, you know, what you have to understand here is the, you know, sheer casual attitude that Antony and, you know, Lepidus have towards this entire process. So when they walk in, Antony, Octavius, and Lepidus, you know, Antony says, these many then shall die. Their names are pricked. Their names have been marked. And then Octavius says, you know, your brother must die. Do you agree? He tells Lepidus. And Lepidus says, yes, I agree. Okay. And then Lepidus says that Mark Antony's nephew must die. And Mark Antony says, sure, your brother for my nephew. I agree. Let's kill them all. Understand? So, you know, this kind of transaction that happens is disturbing because it tells you the nature of these three men who are out to avenge the blood of Caesar. Understand? Now, the conspirators, when they did what they did, they had done it for the sake of the Republic, for sake of maintaining the integrity of the Republic. But these men here are doing it out of a sense of personal revenge. Understand? They don't seem to have the scruples that the conspirators had. So that is a very significant difference between them and the conspirators. Okay. Now, when Lepidus leaves, you know, Octavius and Antony have a conversation about him. Now, Octavius is the heir of Julius Caesar. He is also his great-grandnephew. Understand? So that is a connection between them. Now, Antony calls Lepidus a very unmeritable individual. You know, one of those people who you should just be sending out on errands, making them do menial jobs. You should never entrust your responsibility with them. Okay. And then Octavius says, then why is it that you are consulting him with regard to whom to kill, whom to, you know, spare, and why are you involving him in all of this decision-making process? Why is he part of our triumvirate? Okay. To which Antony says, Octavius, I am, you know, older than you. I have seen more days than you. So it's on the strength of that that I'm telling you that we need a scapegoat. Okay. We need a scapegoat on whom we can, you know, kind of foist all the blame or the fallout that can come as a result of our actions. See, he calls Lepidus an ass, a donkey that carries the gold. Okay, the donkey is going to sweat and labor and so on and carry the gold to its destination, wherever the gold is supposed to go. After that, what people do is that they take the gold away from the donkey and set it out to pasture, to graze, right? That's it. The donkey has no stake in the gold. The donkey is never given the gold. if you think about it. So he says you have to treat him just like that. Okay. So Octavius says, but he is a very brave soldier. And Antony, you know, very, very interestingly says, so is my horse. I had trained my horse to turn and, you know, fight and help me in battle and so on. But, you know, that doesn't mean that, you know, I'm going to give him, you know, decision-making roles. I'm not going to put him at the head of my army. He says, what I have done is I have given my horse the food that he deserves. Understand? So, you know, he says, don't talk about Lepidus, that is line 40. Don't talk of him except as property. And then he says, now listen, Octavius, great things. Brutus and Cassius are levying powers. We must straight make head. So he says that, you know, they both, Brutus and Cassius, are gaining power. What happens is that, you know, actually speaking, after killing Caesar and, you know, this rebellion to the rebellion comes up, what happens is that, you know, these people, they kind of divide their forces into two, and, you know, Brutus and Cassius start gaining a great deal of power on the eastern side of Rome, and Octavius and Antonius, what they do is that they capture the main seat of power. So their power grows in the capital, while while Brutus and Cassius, their power grows in the eastern side. Understand? So there is what we would call civil war. Okay? There is civil war in Rome at this point between two factions. Okay? One led by Octavius, Antony, and Lepidus, the second triumvirate, and the other is led by Brutus and Cassius. Okay? So he says, you know, Antony says, let us join our forces and fight this man. So these men, and therefore, you know, let us, you know, kind of overcome our shortcomings. What you don't have, I have. The deficiencies in your army can be covered by mine. But whatever it is, we have to stick together. And then he says, now let us go and, you know, carry out a kind of a discussion with each other about how we have to address the dangers. Okay. And so he, Octavius also agrees. He says, because, you know, there's a lot at stake. And there are a lot of people who are smiling at us, but in their hearts, they wish us ill. Understand? Now, you know, this play is also a discussion of human nature. How human nature is, where, you know, what is seen on the face may not be what is there actually in the heart. Understand? So we, in a number of plays of Shakespeare, we have seen this frequent questioning of people's intentions. Understand? And Shakespeare, through a lot of his plays, like Othello for that matter, or Hamlet, has pointed out the duplicity of human beings. Understand? Where they are one, where they show a face, but their hidden face is something very dangerous and dark. Understand? So this, you know, in fact, in one play, I think it's in Hamlet, where he says, you know, seems, madam. Okay. So it's like, you know, something seems, does not seem right. And the answer that comes is seems. Okay. So it's the play on the idea of what seems or what doesn't seem. Understand? The apparent and the not so apparent. Yes, Gauri? Oh, that was an accident. Okay. Now that brings us to the end of that particular scene. Okay, so first what we have seen is, we have seen the second triumvirate discussing their problems. Now we come to the next scene where, you know, you see the other side, the other faction. So you have Brutus, Lucilius, Lucius, and the army. And you have Titinius and Pindarus. Titinius is the best friend of Cassius, and Pindarus is Cassius's slave. You know, Cassius had rescued him, so he's Cassius's slave. All right. Now Brutus is currently camping at a place called Sardi, and he had sent word to Cassius. Understand? Now Brutus's messenger returns after meeting Cassius, and Brutus asks him, you know, how was he received? Okay. So Lucius, Brutus asked Lucius, a word, Lucilius, how he received you, let me be resolved. That is line 11, 13, yeah. So he says, tell me, Lucilius, how were you received by Cassius? And Lucilius says, with courtesy and respect enough, but not with such familiar instances, nor with such free and friendly conference as he hath used of old. So he says, earlier, you know, Cassius used to receive me in a very friendly fashion and talk in a very open and friendly manner. But now he is rather formal, he is quite distant. And Brutus says, you have described a distancing friendship.
Excuse me, ma'am. Your network connection is lost, I guess.
Can you hear me?
Now I can. Can you speak once more, ma'am?
Brutus.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you're clear. You're clear.
Okay. So till where did you hear me?
Brutus telling Cassius about what he described, and thou hast described.
No, Lucilius was telling Brutus about.
I'm sorry, Lucilius, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Lucilius tells what's his name? Brutus, that Cassius was rather distant with him. Okay, was rather cold and distant and formal with him, whereas that was not the case once upon a time. And Brutus says, what you just described to me is the cooling of a friendship. Okay, when a friendship becomes rather, you know, when the expiry date of a friendship nears, this is how people behave in an oddly formal manner. So he says, ever note Lucilius, that is, always remember Lucilius, when love begins to sicken and decay, it useth an enforced ceremony. So see, when, you know, there is the love is declining, when the love is receding, then what happens is that it uses exaggerated formality, like, oh, how are you? You know, that kind of a very, 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 very polite kind of demeanor comes about. He says that, he compares these kind of hollow friendships to, bad horses. See, there are two kinds of horses. There are very good horses, you know, they are pure breeds and so on, thoroughbreds. And then there are those, you know, that are called hacks, okay, which are, terrible horses. They don't run well, they don't have stamina, nothing of that sort, okay. So he says, you know, good friendships are like thoroughbreds. But bad friendships are friendships when they start to decay, when they start to decline, then, you know, they are like these hack horses. What is meant by that is that when you apply the spurs to them, when you, you know, kind of poke them in the sides to make them run faster, or when the time comes for you to realize your friendship or ask something of your friend, then it just falls apart. Understand? Just as, you know, you have a hack horse and you're running in a race, when you try to, you know, spur it, you know, kind of encourage it to run faster, it will just collapse. It will just refuse to do so. Similarly, there are friendships which will not last the course. They will just collapse. So he says, now that, you know, bad times are upon us, there is trouble brewing, this man, Cassius, has proved himself to be a false friend. Lucilius, says that the cavalry, okay, the army of the horses have also come with Cassius. Now Brutus says, there he has arrived. Let us go and meet him. And, you know, immediately Cassius says, my dear brother, you have done me wrong. And Brutus says, I have never even wronged my enemies. And how would I then wrong a brother? How would I wrong my friend? How would I wrong you, who are supposed to be my relative? And, Cassius says, this serious attitude of yours, that is line 40, this sober form of yours hides wrongs. And when you do them, so he says, see, this serious manner of yours, this very formal manner of yours, it hides the fact that you do make mistakes. And when you make mistakes, and then Brutus immediately interrupts. He says, Cassius, be content. Speak your griefs softly. I do know you well. Before the eyes of both our armies here, let us not wrangle. Bid them move away. Then in my tent, Cassius, enlarge your griefs and I will give you audience. Understand. So again, what you see is that, you know, Brutus is reluctant to have his faults discussed in public. The minute, you know, Cassius addresses those faults, he shuts him down. He tells him, come to my tent. Okay, let us not fight in front of our armies here. Come to my tent and we will discuss things over there. Okay, and he makes sure that, you know, Lucius guards the tent. Okay, Lucius and Titinius guard the tent and nobody comes in the interim period. Okay, so what you see is that in the Act 4, Scene 1, there is increasing camaraderie between Octavius and Antony. Also, you know, Lepidus was the general who enabled this friendship between these two men. Okay, he unites them. That is how they form that triumvirate. But here, in the case of the conspirators, what we see is that there are cracks developing in their relationship. There is a great deal of mistrust. So this is an alliance that is falling apart. Okay, this is an alliance that is falling apart. Right, now we come to Act 4, Scene 3. Okay, and here it is, you know, remember, Brutus tells Cassius, come in and we will discuss these matters at great length. And this is a very, very interesting scene. See, Julius Caesar is considered to be not one of Shakespeare's best works. But this scene is considered to be one of his greatest scenes on account of the way that, you know, the nature of the conflict, the nature of the argument unfolds. Okay. And it brings to the forefront a lot of, you know, questions such as those of morality, those of the principles of war as opposed to the economics of war. Understand? So where should a human being stand? Should he stand by the principles of war or should he stand by the economics of war? Because war has its own economics. Understand? So, you know, you can't be completely honest when you are fighting a war. There are some things that you have to disregard. There are some compromises that you have to make. I think one of you raised that question of, you know, between immobility, immovability and compromise. This is one aspect of it. Understand? So, you know, Cassius says, you have, you know, kind of wronged me. Understand? He says that you went ahead and punished Lucius Pella for taking bribes from the Sardians. Okay? This person called Lucius Pella. And he says, I wrote you a letter asking you to pardon him. And yet you did not. Understand? And therefore, I insulted. And Brutus says, you should not have written such a letter in the first place. Okay. And then Cassius says that this is not the time when you treat every offense, you know, in all its seriousness. You have to disregard a few things. So Lucius Pella took some bribes. But Lucius Pella has his own uses. We should not forget that. You know, to which Brutus tells him, to his face, rather brutally actually, you yourself are known to have an itching palm. That is, I have heard that you have the reputation of taking bribes, that you are corrupt, okay, that you exchange favors, you use your position and, you know, do favors for people and accept money in return. And Cassius says, if somebody else except Brutus had said that, I would have killed him. This would be his last speech. And Brutus says, the name of Cassius honors this corruption and chastisement doth therefore hide his head. He says, you know, because the name of Cassius is attached to this crime of corruption, you know, people are not punishing anybody. Okay, so, you know, nobody is punishing you either because you are such a big name. And Cassius says, punishment. Understand? And Brutus says, remember, March, the Ides of March. Okay, do you remember that particular date? We all plunged our daggers into Caesar for the sake of, you know, honesty, for the sake of justice. Do you not remember that Julius Caesar died because we thirsted for justice? And he says, who touched his body who did not want justice? Every one of those men who killed him desired justice. And now, and he calls him, he calls Caesar the foremost man in of all this world. Listen, he calls him the foremost man of all this world. And he says, why did he kill him? Why did we kill one of the best individuals in all this world? Because he was supporting, corruption. Because he was authoritarian. Because he wouldn't give us justice. And now, can we contaminate those fingers which clamored for justice? Can we contaminate those by, you know, supporting those people who accepted bribes? Can we in turn accept bribes and dirty our hands? Those hands which killed Caesar for the sake of justice. So you see, this is Brutus's thought process. Okay, this is his logic. He says that this, all of us, we killed Caesar that day for the sake of justice. Then with those very hands, how can we accept bribes or condone bribery? How can we accept bribes or condone bribery? So he says, I'd rather be a dog howling at the moon than be such a Roman. Okay. So Cassius says, Brutus, don't anger me. Don't make me angry. I will not bear it. He says, you forget that I am a soldier and I am older than yourself and more experienced than yourself. Okay. And I have the capability to decide matters. See, all this time, you know, Cassius deferred to Brutus. Okay. He kind of let Brutus take a lot of judgments, most of which went wrong. You know all about that. The way he allowed Antony to speak, the way he spared Antony, all of these were mistakes on the part of Brutus. Okay. So he says, I am capable of taking decisions and I am better than you at that. And Brutus says, you are not. And Cassius says, I am. Brutus says, you are not. And Cassius says, now don't make me angry or I will forget myself and you should be careful about your health. Don't, you know, irritate me further. And Brutus says, move away, you worthless man. And Cassius wonders, is it possible that, you know, such an accusation can be raised against me? And Brutus says, hear me. Must I give way and room to your rash anger? Shall I be frightened just because a madman is glaring at me, just because a madman is getting angry with me? Okay. And Cassius is finding all of this unbearable. And Brutus says, don't show your anger towards me. Go frighten your slaves. Go frighten, you know, your, tenants with all this anger. Okay. I am not going to be impressed or intimidated by your anger. Okay. And he says, today onwards, you know, I will think of you and be amused. Okay. I refuse to be angry with looking at you. I am going to be amused by you. And Cassius says, has our interaction, our relationship come to this? This is what we have deteriorated into. And Brutus says, you said you are a better soldier. Fine. Then why don't you prove yourself to be a better soldier? I rather go and learn about noble men. Okay. Or I'd rather go and learn from noble men. There's a play on the words there. Okay. So he says, you go be a soldier. I, on the other hand, would like to practice higher ethics in life. I would like to learn from noble men, or I would like to learn about noble men. And Cassius says, you are wronging me. You are misunderstanding me in every fashion. Okay, I said an older soldier, not a better soldier. Did I say I'm a better soldier? He says, even if you did, I don't care. And Cassius says, when Caesar lived, he did not dare make me so angry. Okay. And Brutus says, you did not dare make him angry. Okay. And Cassius says, I dared not. And Brutus says, no. It's like, what? I dared not make him angry. Then he says, you dared not make him angry. Then he says, you know, Cassius says, don't imagine that my love for you is so great that I will allow this insult to pass. And then, you know, Brutus embarks on another speech, that is line 66. You have done that you should be sorry for. There is no terror, Cassius, in your threats. For I am armed so strong in honesty that they pass me as the idle wind which I respect not. I did send to you for certain sums of gold which you denied me. For I can raise no money by wild means. By heaven, I had rather coin my heart and drop my blood for drachmas than to wring from the hard hands of peasant their wild trash by any indirection. I did
Ma'am, your audio.
Your audio is.
Excuse me, ma'am, your screen is stuck.
Even her audio is stuck.
Yeah, everything is stuck. I thought I left the meeting. No, I didn't leave the meeting. The meeting's going on, but then her audio just got stuck.
She left the meeting.
We'll wait here, right? She will.
Yes. We'll wait here.
She still left the record on, so.
Hi, I'm so sorry, my connection went off. Am I back again?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Oh, yes, ma'am.
Where did the people hear till?
Ma'am, you were telling about the Brutus' speech somewhere.
Oh, so nothing much has been lost. Good.
No. 974, by any indirection. You were reading that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Cool. So, yeah, so I think, yeah, by any indirection. Yes, so you know, Brutus says that you have wronged me because I am so honest, I am so steeped in honesty that I cannot imagine a situation where, you know, I have to resort to corruption. It is not possible for me. And not only that, I am so honest that whatever threats you make are not going to affect me at all. You understand? And he says, I did write to you. I asked you for some money to pay my soldiers. Because you know, I can never, you know, earn money through wrong means and pay my soldiers. So I requested you to give me money. And you know that, you know, rather than earn money through any wrong means, I would rather, you know, squeeze my heart and, you know, kind of bleed my heart for money. And yet you refuse to give me money. Okay, and he says, would I have answered Caius Cassius that way if I had money? The day that, you know, I deny my friends money, the day that I behave in this terrible fashion towards my friends, I request that, you know, the gods kill me. Now see, he is unwilling to have his hands dirty. Okay, Brutus also knows that there is no other way of getting this money than, you know, obtaining it by hook or crook, by bribery, by corruption, by, you know, imposing taxes upon people. See, that is why he says, than to wring from the hard hands of peasants their wild trash by any indirection. Okay, so he knows that, but he doesn't want to do it. And he is angry that Cassius did not give him the money. Now, where does he imagine that Cassius gets the money from? Right? So it's this ethical problematics. This is what I was saying, that, you know, Brutus is a man who stands at the crossroads between the ethics of war and the economics of war. Okay? So on one hand, he is angry with Cassius for not having given him money to pay his soldiers. On the other hand, he is unwilling to resort to, you know, obtaining money by hook or crook for his soldiers. But at the same time, he is, as Rima is pointing out, waiting for Cassius to somehow extract the money and give it to him. As if, you know, getting the money from Cassius is going to make that money less ethically problematic. Understand? So this is very interesting. And Cassius says, I did not refuse you the money. Okay, and Brutus insisted he did, to which Cassius says, I did not. The man who brought my message back to you, he has made some kind of a mistake. Understand? And he says, Brutus, you are magnifying my faults beyond what they actually are. And Brutus says, I did not do that. But you are the one who is, you know, practicing those faults on me. And Cassius says, you do not love me. Brutus says, I don't like your faults. I don't like your character. And Cassius says, a friendly eye would never see these as faults. And Brutus says, a flatterers would not, though they do appear as high as huge Olympus. So what, you know, Brutus is trying to say is that if somebody are trying to flatter you, they would have ignored all your faults, that, you know, you are probably corrupt, or that, you know, you are probably extracting money from peasants, etc. They might overlook it. But for an honest man, your faults are as high as Mount Olympus. Now, Cassius says, come, Antony, come, Octavius. Okay, and take your revenge upon Cassius, because Cassius is tired of this world. He is tired of being misunderstood. Okay, the people whom he loves, they hate him. His brother, that is, you know, Brutus, misunderstands him. Okay, he is being treated like a slave. Okay, and all his mistakes are being magnified, they are being written down, learned by heart, and, you know, spouted out at the every given opportunity. Okay, and he says, here is my dagger, here is my chest. Okay, and, you know, I would like to, you know, he says, and here my naked breast within a heart dearer than Pluto's mind. It is not Pluto. Pluto is the god of the underworld. Here what he means is Plutus. Okay, the god of wealth. Okay, Plutus, the god of wealth. So he says, you know, this, you know, I have a heart that is, you know, richer than the gold mine of Plutus. Okay, so if you want, you know, just stab it. Okay, and if you think that I denied you gold, then, you know, you can take my heart instead, because my heart is richer than the gold mines of the god of wealth. And he says, strike me, kill me as you killed Caesar. Okay, because I know that you know, even when you hated him the most, you still loved him more than you loved me. Understand? Even when you hated him the most, okay, you did not love me as much. It's a very interesting concept. Now, Brutus says, put your knife away. Okay. And, you know, you be angry when the time is appropriate. Okay. And he says that, you know, you are friends with a lamb. That is, you know, I'm a very, very innocent minded individual. And he says that, you know, I don't carry my anger. I don't carry any grudges any more than a flint carries fire. Flint is a piece of stone. You know, you strike two flint together and it produces a spark. And that is when, you know, you can put it onto the straw or hay and it catches fire. So, you know, the flint does not carry fire. It only produces a spark. That's it. He's like, that's all I am. You know, when I'm angered, I might have an outburst. But otherwise, I am by nature very peaceable. Now, Cassius says, hath Cassius lived to be but mirth and laughter to his Brutus when grief and blood ill-tempered vexed him? Okay, so he says, you know, you said you're going to think of me as a big joke. And Brutus says, I was also angry at that time. Okay, so he says, Cassius says, do you agree or admit that you were angry? Then give me your hand. Brutus says, my hand and my heart, I gave it all to you. And then Cassius, you know, says, don't be angry with me, I just have my mother's hot temper. And Brutus says, next time you're angry with me, I will imagine that, you know, it is your mother and I will forgive you. Okay, very interesting. And the meanwhile, you know, they have made peace. Now they are great friends again. And then comes in a poet. Okay, now see, these poets are playing a very interesting role in this play. Now poet says that, you know, let me go into the tent and meet the two generals. There is some anger going on between them. By which time, you know, these two people, Cassius and Brutus, come out. And, you know, Brutus treats the poet very, very shabbily. You know, Brutus says, get you hence, sirrah, saucy fellow. And Cassius says, you know, be tolerant of him. That is how he speaks. And Brutus says, I will show him, you know, I will tolerate his humor when he uses it at the appropriate place. Understand? So, you know, this reference here apparently is to Marcus Fabius, a poet. And apparently, in some instances, it is said that Shakespeare himself played this role. Okay. So this, you know, apart from providing a much needed, you know, comic relief, it is a scene that, you know, kind of tells you how high the tensions run in Brutus's mind, because he is normally a very tolerant individual, but his nature has changed. Understand? He is extremely angry and very, very upset. Okay. And the way he speaks to Cassius tells you that, you know, there has been a very serious change of character. His innermost core has changed. Now, the way he treats this hapless poet, this poor poet, also tells you that something is the matter. And then, you know, when the poet and everybody leaves, Cassius tells Brutus, I did not know that you could have been so angry. And Brutus says, I am very sad. And he says, what is the matter? And Brutus says, Portia is dead. Okay. And Cassius is like, Portia, how did she die? Okay. And Brutus says, she was very, very upset by my prolonged absence, because she was still in the capital in that place, while I am located here. She was, you know, upset by my absence. Then there was also this grief that Octavius and Mark Antony are strengthening their position. And, you know, he says, I learned of this information when I got the news of her death. Okay. And then, you know, with all of this, she felt extremely depressed, and she swallowed fire when her servants were not there and died. Swallowed fire is, according to Plutarch, she is supposed to have swallowed hot coals and killed herself. Okay? Hot coals and killed herself. It's a terrible way to die. And Cassius says, she died. And Brutus says, yes. And then, you know, Cassius can't believe it, but Brutus says, don't speak about her anymore and give me some more wine. And he says, with this wine, I want to bury our anger. I want to bury our outburst. Okay. And Cassius says, I agree. And, you know, he drinks a cup to Brutus's love. Okay. And again, you know, Cassius wonders how she could have died. Portia could have died. And Brutus says, I beg you, let's not talk about it. And, you know, they talk about them, about Octavius and Mark Antony strengthening their position and moving towards Philippi. Okay, they are coming with a massive army and they are moving towards Philippi. And Messala, another general, says, I also have the same information. Okay, and, you know, he says that Messala further adds that, so Octavius and Antony together have killed 100 senators. And Brutus says, I read that there were only 70 senators. He says, no, there were 100 senators. And Cicero, the great orator, was one among them. Okay. So Cassius does not agree that they should march and meet Octavius's and Antony's armies at Philippi. And Brutus says, what is your reason? And Cassius says, it is better that the enemy comes looking for us, so that, you know, his resources are tired, his soldiers are tired, while we can sit here, rest, and, you know, we can be completely alert and active when they attack us. So he says, that is a good reason. But, you know, the people of Philippi are there between us and these people, because they are right now at Sardi, and, you know, the army is marching towards Philippi. Okay. So he says, you know, as we march through this place, more people will be added to our army. We will have a stronger army if we move from here. There will be more people joining us. Understand? So Cassius says, listen to me, Brutus. And Brutus says, no, you must note that besides, we have stayed at this place, at Sardi, for a very long time. Okay, so the people who are supporting us, they are under a great amount of economic strain. So we can't, you know, continue staying here because it is going to cause them a lot of stress and they're going to be angry. Understand? Yes. So he says, while the going is good, while it is good for us, we should move out of here. So Cassius says, fine, then I will agree with you and I will do the same thing. This is another strategic mistake that these two are making. Okay, so he says, okay, fine. We'll also move and we will meet them at Philippi. Now, you know, Brutus is extremely tired. Cassius is also tired and they are going to go to sleep. And in the meanwhile, you know, Brutus asks two men to sleep in his tent. He asks his boy, Lucius, to play a musical instrument. And, you know, there is darkness in the tent. And, you know, Brutus is gradually dropping off when, that is line 273 or 4, enter the ghost of Caesar. Okay. So now what happens is there's a candle and the candle is flickering. So Brutus says, how ill this taper burns. Ha, who comes here? I think it's the weakness of mine eyes that shapes this monstrous apparition. It comes upon me. Art thou anything? Art thou some god, some angel, or some devil that makes my blood cold and my hair to stare? Speak to me what thou art. Understand? So, you know, this candle is flickering. That kind of an eeriness pervades the air. Okay, and he says, I don't know what it is. Maybe it's the weakness of my eyes that, you know, this figure is looking like a monster, that it looks like an apparition. It is not very clear. And he asks, what are you? What are you that, you know, my blood is running cold and my hair is standing on end? And the ghost says, thy evil spirit, Brutus. Now, this could be Caesar. Take revenge upon Brutus. It could also be that, you know, it is the conscience, the guilty conscience of Brutus that is standing there and talking to him. Okay, that maybe in his deepest, you know, instincts, he knows that he has wronged Caesar by killing him in this cavalier fashion. And so, you know, this is him coming face to face with his conscience. That's why, thy evil spirit, Brutus. And then Brutus says, why have you come? And ghost says, I have come to tell you that I will see you at, you will see me at Philippi. And he says, well, will I see you again? And he says, yes, you will see me at Philippi. And then the ghost vanishes. Understand? Meanwhile, Lucius wakes up with a cry. And the other two men also, you know, Varro and Claudius also wake up with screams. And no, none of them remember screaming in their sleep. Understand? So now Brutus tells them to go wake Cassius and then, you know, they have to set out as soon as is possible. Understand? Yes. That brings us to the end of Act 4. Okay. And in this act, you know, we see the consequences of everything that happened in Act 3. Right? Where in Act 3, all the conspirators got together and, you know, murdered Caesar. Now in Act 4, we see that factions have been formed after the death of Caesar. One, where there's a second triumvirate that has been formed by Lepidus, Octavius Caesar, and Antony. And they are united. They have purpose. Though, you know, their attitude is rather bloodthirsty. They lack conscience. They are not working out of a sense of, you know, justice. They are not working for the betterment of Rome. They are trying to, you know, further their own cause. In fact, Antony sends Lepidus to get Caesar's will so that he can find out if there is any way of taking the orchards, the parks, or any part of, you know, Caesar's property back from the people. Understand? So this is, you know, the attitude that Antony has. Now, on the other hand, you know, this faction that has Cassius and Brutus, is fighting with each other on the basis of ideals, okay, where Brutus wants to hold on to his ideals at the same time get money without dirtying his hands. And then you have Cassius, whose every decision is being undermined or rejected by Brutus, and because of that they are making one mistake after the other. So on one hand, you find there is a relationship that is being strengthened on the basis of corruption and economics, as is the you know, the case with the second triumvirate. And on the other hand, you find another relationship that is crumbling or breaking down on account of these very factors. Okay, ideals and economics. Okay, and Brutus finds himself standing right at the crossroads between ethics and economics. Understand? So that brings us to the end of Act 4. Do you have anything that you would like to raise at this point?
Ma'am, excuse me, ma'am. Can you repeat that once more?
What?
Ma'am, why Brutus is actually confused or in between these two ideals?
See, that is because, you know, Brutus does not want to get his hands dirty. He does not want to, you know the source of the money, where it is coming from. Though he knows that it has to be some unscrupulous means. Okay, he wants Cassius to pay him money, understand, to pay his soldiers. But he himself will not stand for any corruption. Do you understand the conundrum that, you know, Brutus himself presents, the ideological problem that he presents? He wants the money. Okay, he does not want to know where he got it from, where Cassius gets it from, but Cassius has to give him the money. That is one side. But on the other side, you know, he punishes people whom he thinks have been corrupt, despite Cassius telling him not to do so. So on one hand, he refuses to compromise on his principles. He says, I am very, very honest, I will not compromise. But on the other hand, he is willing to accept money from Cassius, which might have come as a result of Cassius accepting bribes or Cassius compromising on some grounds or the other. Is that clear now?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Yes.
Excuse me, ma'am.
Yes, tell me.
Ma'am, at this point, is Cassius manipulating Brutus in any way? Like, he is kind of talking in a way as if he's trying to evoke sympathy in Brutus, some kind of sympathy.
No, see, actually, you see that, you know, at this point, Cassius, there is nothing that Cassius can do that can, you know, sway Brutus. Because even when he says that we will not go to Philippi, Brutus says, no, we must go to Philippi, and Cassius falls along with that, right? And he's not even able to kind of bring out a clarity of the situation when, you know, he says that, you know, you did not pardon the man that I sent a request for. Right, so none of Cassius's concerns are being addressed here. So I don't think that Cassius still is managing to manipulate Brutus, because, you know, Brutus is so hung up on his honesty. So there is nothing that, you know, Cassius can do at this point that will make Brutus backtrack. Understand?
Okay. Yes.
Anything else? So shall we move to Act 5 then?
Yes, ma'am.
Act 5 has five
scenes. Yes, ma'am.
Act 5 has five scenes, and they are significant in their own ways. You will see how. So first, what we see is that there is the battle happening at Philippi. Okay. Now, Antony and Octavius and Brutus and Cassius, they are all preparing for their battles. Okay, if you want to think of it as one of those new generation movies, you'll have the screen split into two. You have, you know, Octavius and Antony and Brutus and Cassius. Okay. And Brutus and Cassius, you know, they feel that their, you know, this, these battles might finally come to an end. So there is a bit of emotion that is there between them. Okay, now, Octavius says, Antony, you had told me that the enemy would not come down to meet us, but here they are. Understand? So, you know, he says this army, that is Brutus and Cassius's army, is planning to meet us at Philippi, where they will try to overcome us. So Antony says, even I don't understand how this happened, you know. So then he says, maybe they are trying to do this just to show how brave and strong they are and thus intimidate us. So see, Antony and Cassius thought like soldiers. Understand? That is why Cassius said, don't go there to meet them. Let us be here rested and fit and fine. Let them come walking, drain their resources. Let them get tired and ill, and then we can fight them. Understand? Antony also thought the same thing, that those people won't lose their advantage. They won't come here. We'll have to go there. Okay. Ah. Now, the messenger comes and says, the army is coming down. That is, Brutus and Cassius' army is coming down in full splendor. Their, you know, battle signs are all out. Okay. Now, Octavius and Antony plan their battle positions. There is a bit of argument about that. And in the middle, what they do is that, you know, Brutus and Cassius and Antony and Octavius have come for parley. Okay, that is a possibility of trying to establish a dialogue or some peace before the war. Okay, they've come to talk. Yes. So, you know, in line 24, Octavius asks Mark Antony, Mark Antony, shall we give sign of battle? And Antony says, no, Caesar. We will answer on their charge. Make forth. The generals would have some words. See, he naturally starts calling him Caesar, replacing one with the other. Now, Octavius says, tells his army, don't move till we give the signal. Okay. Now, Brutus says, words before blows. Is it so, countrymen? So he says, yeah. So we'll have conversation before we fight. Okay. Then Octavius says, not that we love words better as you do. He says, you are the one who loves words and not action. You know, that's a reference to the fact that Brutus used to be a judge, a praetor. And Brutus says, good words are better than bad strokes, Octavius. So now Brutus is referring to Octavius's powers in battle, because Octavius is very young. So he says, yeah, my good words are better than your bad jibes in the battle. And Antony says, in your bad strokes, Brutus, you give good words. Witness the hole you made in Caesar's heart, crying, long live, hail Caesar. Okay, so he says, even when you stab badly, you speak very well. Remember the words that you spoke when you poked a hole in Caesar. You said, long live and hail Caesar and all. Those were such good words. But the strokes that you gave were very bad. They were fatal. And Cassius says, Antony, the posture of your blows are yet unknown. But for your words, they rob the Hybla bees and leave them honeyless. So he says, I have not seen how good you are in battle. I have not seen the shape and the depth of your blows. But as far as your words are concerned, you will rob the best honeybees of their honey. Such sweetness is there in your words. And this is a reference to Mark Antony's funeral oration, which drove the crowds into a frenzy and unleashed havoc upon all of Rome. Now, Hybla bees are, you know, bees of the Mount Hybla, which are prized for the quality of their honey. Okay. Now, Antony says, I'm not stingless too. He says, yes, you know, my words can sting as well. And Brutus says, yes, and soundless too. So he says, yeah, you have, your words are sweet and they're full of sting and they buzz, you know, they have that that quality about them which drove the crowds into a frenzy. Brutus says, so that is why, you know, you are threatening before you sting. So they feel that, you know, Antony may not go forward with the battle. And Antony gets angry. He says, villains, you did not so when your vile daggers hacked one another in the sides of Caesar. You showed your teeth like apes and fawned like hounds and bowed like bondmen, kissing Caesar's feet, whilst damned Casca, like a cur, a dog, behind struck Caesar on the neck. Oh, you flatterers. So Brutus is like, yeah, you are warning us before you fight, I suppose. And Antony says, you did not even warn Caesar before you struck him down in that shameless fashion. You bowed and scraped before him. You behaved like his slaves. And then, like, you know, Casca, like a dog, he went and he attacked Caesar. And then all of you killed him. You are flatterers. And Cassius says, flatterers? Now, Brutus, okay, so he tells Brutus. See, this is what happens. You should thank yourself. You are responsible for allowing this man to be alive here today. I told you then itself you should kill him. But now, see, he is standing here and he is talking to us in this fashion. Now Octavius says, come on, come on. If arguing is going to make us sweat, okay, then the proof of this, the anger that is caused by this argument is going to be seen in the form of blood on the battlefield. And he says, we will avenge the 33 wounds that you inflicted upon Caesar, or there will be another Caesar who will join the dead Caesar. So he means to say that either he will avenge the death of Caesar or he will die. Brutus says, Caesar, you cannot die by the hands of traitors, okay? No traitor is going to kill you unless you have brought the traitor with you. By that, he's referring to Antony. Then Octavius says, I hope so, because, you know, I was not born to die on Brutus's sword. I'm not going to die at your hands. Then Brutus says, my dear young man, even if you were the greatest Caesar of your family, you know, your death could not have been more honorable had you died at my hands. So see, even at this point when, you know, matters are quite serious, Brutus is so proud of his honorable nature, of his reputation of honor, his credibility, that he says that even if you are the greatest of your family, you should consider it an honor if you die at my hands. Okay. And Cassius says, a peevish schoolboy, that is a rather annoyed tantrum throwing schoolboy, is worthless of such honor of dying at the hands of Brutus. And this, you know, peevish, this annoyed, this angry sulking schoolboy has gone and joined with a masker and a reveler. See, that's what he calls Antony. Okay, remember I told you he was given to revels and he enjoyed, you know, all night orgies and drinking and so on. So, you know, that's what Cassius is referring to. And this mask is a reference to the Elizabethan, entertainment of masks. Okay, where people would dress up as gods and goddesses and carry out processions and, you know, displays, and they would carry out tableaus and so on. And all of this was great, you know, greatly enjoyed and celebrated. So through that reference, again, it's a small anachronism, but, you know, Shakespeare does it so that, you know, the people can understand the kind of revels that Antony was prone to have. Now, Antony says, Cassius, let us go. And okay, now Brutus calls Lucilius and takes him aside. Okay, and Cassius calls Messala and takes him aside. So there are two conversations happening on the stage, but we can hear only one. Okay, now there Brutus and you know, Lucilius are talking, but that conversation is muted. What we can hear is the conversation between Cassius and Messala. Okay, and that is when we realize it is Cassius's birthday today. Okay, and he says that, you know, once upon a time I believed in the theory of Epicurus, that is that the gods never interfere in the activities of men, that, you know, they don't care about us, which means that things like omens and signs, etc., they don't mean anything. Okay, they don't mean anything. But now, of late, you know, considering everything, I have begun to believe in omens. Okay. And he gives an example. He says, when we were coming from Sardi, you should remember that now they are at Philippi. When they were coming from Sardi, you know, there were two mighty eagles that joined the group, that hovered over the group. And, you know, they would eat from the hands of our soldiers and so on. But when we arrived at Philippi, those eagles, you know, just fell off. They did not, you know, come with us to Philippi. Instead, we have been joined by ravens, crows, and kites. See, while, you know, eagles are mighty hunters and they are seen as symbols of nobility, these birds, okay, ravens, crows, and kites are carrion birds. Understand? Which means that, you know, they feast on dead flesh. Okay, they are those, you know, eternal waste pickers of nature. Understand? They feed on dead things. Okay, so now instead of those two mighty eagles, which were signs of nobility and good fortune, here are ravens, crows, and kites, carrion birds. Yes, scavengers. Okay, scavenger birds, correct. Right? And they are flying over us and they are looking downwards as if we are sickly prey, as if, we are their prey and we are rather weak. I don't know if you have seen vultures, when some creature is almost dying, they all start congregating on one side and they are waiting. Okay, they will be waiting. And then, they start moving closer with each, amount of weakening that the prey is experiencing. So, it's like they are all looking at us like, we are sickly prey. And their shadow seems like a canopy, a cover under which, our army looks like it is going to die and perish completely. Now, Messala says, don't believe that. Then Cassius says, I kind of believe it. Okay, but he says, but that's okay because I am prepared for any end. I am ready for anything now. Okay, and then by then, Brutus's conversation with Lucilius ends. So Lucilius, Brutus tells Lucilius, even so. So then the audience knows that that conversation is over. Then Cassius ends this conversation with Messala and looks at Brutus and says, now, most noble Brutus, the gods, are friendly. Okay. And he says, may we remain friends to the end of our time. Okay. And if we lose this battle, then this is the last time that we speak to each other. Okay. And he says, what are you going to do if this is the last time that we are speaking together? Then Brutus says that there has to be some power that governs us. Okay. And the time of life. For fear of what might fall, so to prevent the time of life, arming myself with patience to stay the providence of some high powers that govern us below. So he says, I'm just waiting for the judgment that will come. Okay, I am also biding my time. I'm not in any kind of hurry. Okay, now Cassius says, if you lose this battle, are you willing to be led through the streets of Rome in chains? Brutus says, no, Cassius, no. Okay, never think, you noble Roman, that Brutus will ever go in chains to Rome. Okay, and he says, I also have this feeling that today, this day will end the work that began with the Ides of March. And he says, I don't know whether we will meet again or not. Okay, if we meet again, we will smile. If not, then, this parting is the best parting. Let us part at this point of time. If we meet again, then we will smile. Understand? So these are all foreshadowings of the time that is coming. Because see, today is Cassius's birthday. And today is the day that, he feels that, Brutus feels that what started off with the Ides of March is going to come to a conclusion today. So these men feel, instinctually they feel that things are coming to an end. This entire event is coming to an end. Okay, that brings us to the end of this scene. Now, Act 5, Scene 2 is very small. Okay, now, what happens is that in the next scene, it's a very small scene, it's a battle scene where, Antony, fights with Cassius and Octavius fights against the army of Brutus. Understand? Now, what happens is that... he has managed to gain control over Octavius's army. Okay, Brutus has managed to gain control over Octavius's army, but instead of kind of going on progressing to go and help Cassius with Antony's army, these men start looting and pillaging the camp of the enemy. Okay, so there is a bit of indiscipline, and Brutus is unable to control that, but he sends word to Cassius through Messala. That's all that happens here. Now we come to scene 3. Okay, again, in this act, this is a very, very crucial scene. Okay, Cassius looks, to be defeated by Antony. Antony will be defeating Cassius, which, makes Cassius's own men rather anxious, and they start rebelling. They start to mutiny. Understand? Now, what Cassius does is that, you know, he moves aside and tells Titinius, okay, to look what is happening on the scenes of battle. Okay, so Cassius says, look, Titinius, look, the villains fly. Myself have to mine own turned enemy. This ensign here of mine was turning back. I slew the coward and did take it from him. So you see, our own men are, you know, turning against us. This man, the flag bearer, was running away. I killed him and took the flag back. Then Titinius says, Cassius, Brutus gave the word too early, who, having some advantage on Octavius, took it too eagerly. His soldiers fell to spoil, whilst we by Antony are all enclosed. So see, this is what has happened. Brutus gave the command too early. Anyway, they overcame Octavius. They got some advantage over Octavius. But instead of coming and helping us, what has happened is that, you know, these men are looting the enemy camp. Now, Pindarus comes in. Okay, Pindarus says, my dear lord, he tells Cassius, move further away because Antony is now in your territory. He is going through your tents at this point of time. And he tells, Cassius to move away. And Cassius says, I'm anyway far. He says, no, you must move further away. And he can see all his tents catching fire. Antony is setting fire to the enemy camp. Okay, now Cassius says, Titinius, if you love me, okay, get on to my horse, okay, and go real fast up to the, until he have brought thee up to yonder troops. And here again, that I may rest assured whether yon troops are friend or enemy. So he says, go right up and find out whether the enemy, the soldiers who are, you know, located in a certain place, whether they are enemy or whether they are friend. Okay. So Titinius says, I will go and I will come very soon. So now Titinius goes to find out that. Now, it is just Cassius and Pindarus the slave. You should remember that Titinius is Cassius's best friend. And Cassius has sent Titinius to go and look whether, you know, the soldiers that are marching on are friends or enemies. Okay. Now, Cassius tells Pindarus to climb up the hill. He says, my eyesight is not very good. And this was the man who mocked Caesar for his physical, you know, weakness. But Cassius himself is weak in the eyes. And he says, look, Titinius, and tell me what you can see in the field. Okay, I mean, he says, look for Titinius and tell me what you can see, what is happening to him. So Titinius has gone to see whether the soldiers are friends or enemies. Now Cassius sends Pindarus up the hill to check what is happening to Titinius. So now what the audience is hearing is what Cassius is hearing from Pindarus. Okay, yes. So Pindarus is like, oh my lord. And Cassius is like, what is it? He says, Titinius has been surrounded with horsemen. Okay, and he is also trying to outrun them. Now they are almost upon them. They have captured him, and they are getting down. Titinius is also getting down. He has been captured, and they are all shouting for joy because they have captured Titinius. And Cassius is like, come down, don't see anymore. He says, I am a coward that I am living to see my best friend being captured. Okay, and he tells Pindarus, I took you a captive in Parthia. Understand? I took you a captive in Parthia, which is Iran. Okay. And then I swore that, that I will spare your life if you do everything that I say. Now I want you to keep your promise. I want you to kill me. Okay. Okay. So he gives him that sword and he says, I want you to kill me, and in return I will set you free once and for all. Okay, so Pindarus does that. He stabs Cassius, and while dying, Cassius says, Caesar, thou art revenged even with the sword that killed thee. Okay, so it's like, Caesar's ghost has come to all these people and it is seeking revenge. Because all these men are dying with the name of Caesar on their lips. Okay, so this ends the story of Cassius. Okay, and with the remaining of his breath, he sets Pindarus free and tells him to go far off from the shadow of Rome. Okay, now Titinius and Messala come back. Remember that Brutus had sent Messala to tell these people that he has managed to overcome Octavius. Understand? So what Pindarus actually saw was the army of Messala coming forward, informing Titinius that, you know, they have conquered or gained power over Octavius, and they were all celebrating that. But Pindarus, you know, misunderstood the entire situation and narrated something wrong to Cassius, which means that Cassius died as a result of a misunderstanding. Understand? So Messala says, it is but change. Titinius for Octavius is overthrown by noble Brutus's power, as Cassius' legions are by Antony. So see, Octavius has been defeated by Brutus and Cassius has been defeated by Antony. It is just an exchange. Nobody won, nobody lost when you think about it. Now Titinius says, well, anyway, it will be a comfort for Cassius to know that at least we won over and over Octavius. Then, you know, they realize that Cassius is dead. Okay, looking at the way he's lying there. Okay, and Titinius says, Messala says, is that not he? Is that not the form of, the shape of, or the body of Cassius? And Titinius says, no, this was he, Messala. It is not him. It was him. It used to be him. Cassius is no more. O setting sun, line 60. O setting sun, as in thy red rays dost thou sink to night, so in his red blood Cassius's day is set. The sun of Rome is set. Our day is gone. Clouds, dews, and dangers come. Our deeds are done. Mistress of my success has done this deed. Okay, so see here, what has happened is that, you know, in almost a kind of a poetic, you know, a kind of a situation, Cassius died on the day that he was born. Understand? And if morning marks his birthday, then night, his birth, if morning marks his birth, then the night or the evening marks his death. It is like the life, the entire life of an individual has been played out. Okay, so Titinius is extremely sad. Okay, and you know, he says that the sun of Rome is set. Now that is the play on the word sun. It is S-U-N, because anyway it is evening, so that sun has set. At the same time, the S-O-N, sun of Rome, that is Cassius, has also set. Okay, he will never rise again. Okay, and he says, this was because Cassius did not trust that I would succeed. Okay, then Messala says, mistrust of good success is what has done this. So he says, you know, Cassius did not believe that you would not succeed. The entire price would succeed. That is why he killed himself. Understand? Then they're looking for Pindarus, and they know that, you know, I mean, they realize that Pindarus is nowhere to be found. And Messala says, let me go and tell Brutus that this has happened. And he says, I'll have to push this news into Brutus's ear, because he will refuse to accept it. It will be too much for him. Okay. Now Titinius tells Messala to please go. And in the meanwhile, Titinius, unable to bear, the loss of Cassius, he asked the body of Cassius, did you think that the shouts of celebration were actually the shouts of agony? That, you know, I was being captured, I was in danger. Is that why you killed yourself? And he says, you know, I cannot be here without you. Okay, yeah. And that is line 86. Okay. Thy Brutus bid me, Brutus had given Titinius a garland to give Cassius as a mark of victory. Okay, he says, you take this garland, I keep it on your head. Okay, and he says, Brutus told me to give it to you, and I will do what Brutus told me. Okay, and he says, you know, I had a very high opinion of you. I really, really loved you as a friend. And so what I'm going to do is that I'm going to kill myself. And he stabs himself with his sword and he dies. Okay. So this is a story of a great friendship where one friend cannot live without the other friend. Okay. Now what happens is Brutus, Messala, Cato, Strato, Volumnius, and Lucilius also enter. Okay, and Brutus asks, where is the body of Cassius? Okay, now Brutus says, Titinius has also passed away. So, you know. Yes, so Brutus says, are yet two Romans living such as these? The last of all Romans, fare thee well. It is impossible that ever Rome should breed thy fellow. There can never be two Romans like these two. They were great Romans. Okay. And Cassius, I shall find time. Come therefore and to Thasos send his body. His funeral shall not be in our camps, lest it discomfort us. Lucilius, come. And come, young Cato, let us to the field. Labio and Flavius, set our battles on. 'Tis 3 o'clock, and Romans yet ere night. We shall try fortune in a second fight. So see again, the number 3 comes in. Okay, now it is 3 o'clock. And remember that it was exactly more or less at 3 o'clock that, you know, Brutus had been won over by Cassius. And now it is at 3 o'clock that, you know, he starts to finish the events that had been put into motion on that very day. Okay, and that brings us to the end of this act. You know, they do not the scene, they don't want to hold Cassius's funeral in their camps because the troops might be disheartened at the death of such a great leader. Understand? So yeah, now Act 5, Scene 4. Okay, that's again a small act where Lucilius pretends to be Brutus when he is captured by Antony, and Antony in turn spares his life because he is so loyal. He's a, such loyalty must be rewarded, and they spare him. Okay, he is they keep him prisoner, but they spare his life. Okay, that's all that is in that scene. Now in Act 5, Scene 5, this is the final scene of this act as well as of this play. Okay, now Brutus has lost. Remember, at 3 o'clock he wanted to set another battle. He has lost that battle. And here you have, okay, Brutus is there, and he's there with a few of his remaining friends and legions and soldiers. There is Dardanius, then there is Cletus, there is Straw and Volumnius. That's all. Okay, yeah. And, you know, Brutus is heartbroken. His eyes seem to be full of tears. Okay, and he says, I have something to tell you, Volumnius. And Volumnius says, what do you want to tell me? He's like this, that the ghost of Caesar has appeared to me, you know, twice at night, once at Sardi and the other last night in Philippi. When he came in Sardi, what did he say? I will see you at Philippi. Now at Philippi also he appeared, and I know that this is my last hour, that I will not live. Okay, then Volumnius says, don't think that way. Then he says, no, I'm sure, you know. He says, you know, you can see for yourself, Volumnius, how this world is now and how we have been defeated. Okay, and he says, the enemy will not stop. They will go on and on till they defeat us. They will push us into the pit. And he says, I am begging you, hold this sword while I run into it so that I can stab myself and kill. Then he says, that is not the job of a friend. A friend should not do that, you know, hold the sword while his friend runs onto it and kills himself. Okay, then Cletus comes and says, you should run away. You should run away while there is time. And Brutus says, goodbye to you and to you and to you. Okay, I bid goodbye to all of you. Okay, and he says, goodbye, Strato, everybody. Come, men. My heart doth joy that yet in all my life I found no man but he was true to me. I shall have glory by this losing day more than Octavius and Mark Antony, by this wild conquest shall attain unto. So fare you well at once. Okay, so he says, I am going surrounded by friends, and I'm sure that, you know, in this battle I have gained more glory, more honor than Octavius and Mark Antony. See, even in the throes of death, even when he's on the verge of dying, at the verge of utter and total and bitter defeat, he's holding on to the ideas of honor. Okay, he feels that he has gained greater honor and greater glory on the field of battle than Antony and Octavius. But what do the rules of war actually dictate? The rules of war dictate that history belongs to the victor. Okay, but here you have, Brutus who challenges that. Okay, he challenges that fundamental principle of war, that history belongs to the victor, that glory belongs to the victor. Okay, yeah. So, Brutus says, go, I will follow, he tells Cletus. Okay, now, he tells Strato, stay here by your master, stay here by me. And, he says, your life has some bit of honor in it. Okay, so I want to. So he wants to die at the hands of an honorable man. So he tells Strato, because Volumnus has refused, he tells Strato, hold my sword and I will run onto it. Okay, will you do that for me? And Strato says, first give me your hand, shake hands with me. And he bids him farewell. And Strato holds the sword and he runs onto it. And while dying, he says, farewell, good Strato. That is, goodbye, Strato. And then he says, Caesar, now be still. I killed not thee with half so good a will. Okay. So Caesar, at least now you must rest. Okay. I did not kill you with so much of determination as I am now killing myself. Understand? So he admits that even while he stabbed Caesar, he did have some doubts. He did have some reservation, which means that possibly the ghost of Caesar that he kept seeing was in effect his conscience that was going on nagging him. Because on one hand, he kept on saying how honorable and how noble he is and how much he believed in his cause. And, it was because he believed in the truth of, his cause that he stabbed the noblest men of them all. But now, while dying, he says that, I did not kill you with as much belief or determination as I am killing myself right now. So he says, at least now, be still, be at rest, find your salvation, he tells the ghost of Caesar. Now, Octavius says, by then what happens is, Octavius, Antony, Messala, Lucilius, all of them come. Okay. They ask Strato where he is, and Strato says, he is free from the bondage, from the chains that you are in, Messala. Because you know why? Messala has committed himself to Octavius and Antony. So Strato says, he is free from the bondage of life that you are in. Okay, you are in the throes of life. But my master has become free. So he says, the conquerors can make a fire for him because Brutus was defeated only by Brutus. Okay, so Brutus cannot be defeated by any of you because he overcame himself. Understand? Yeah. And he says, no other man has the honor of his death. Nobody else can claim to have killed him. Okay, so he says, so Lucilius says, so Brutus must be found. I thank you, Brutus, that you have proved Lucilius' saying true. Because Lucilius always said that Brutus would rather die than be captured. Okay, yeah. So now they found the body, they ask him, how did he die? And Strato says, I held the sword and he ran onto it. Okay. So now, Messala says, Octavius, take him to follow thee that did the latest service to my master. Okay. So Messala says, let's go with Strato and we will find him. And Antony says, this was the noblest Roman of them all. So while Brutus calls Caesar the noblest Roman, now Antony calls Brutus the noblest Roman. All the conspirators save he did what they did in envy of great Caesar. So see, all of the conspirators, whether it is Trebonius, Cimber, whether it was Casca, Cassius, all of them, they did it out of jealousy towards Caesar, not Brutus. He only in a general honest thought and common good to all made one of them. He says he joined them only out of a sense of honesty, out of genuinely thinking that he is doing some actual good. That is why he joined them. His life was gentle, the elements so mixed in him that nature might stand up and say to all the world, this was a man. So he says, he was a man with wonderful and well-balanced qualities. He was a perfect man. So nature itself might stand up and say that this was a man, you know, the ideal Roman, the ideal human being. Okay, one who had a sweet nature, one who was gentle, one who was sensitive, and one who was honorable and noble. Okay, Octavius also says, according to his virtue, let us use him with all respect and rites of burial. Within my tent his bone shall lie tonight, most like a soldier ordered honorably. So call the field to rest, and let us away to part the glories of this happy day. So, you know, he says, we will bury him with all the honors that he deserves. Tonight, we will keep him, his body in my tent. We will give him all the honors and we will prepare him accordingly. And then, you know, we will give him the funeral. But now come, let us celebrate the joys of our victory. If you notice, Octavius is the one who speaks last in this play, which means that, you know, his position of power is such that his is the last word. Understand? And that brings us to the end of Julius Caesar. Okay? So what Act 4 and 5 have done is that they have established the relationships between the various factions. Okay, they have, these two acts have also laid plain and clear, you know, the consequences of everything that has happened in Act 3. Okay, and it also deals with the questions of the ideology of war, the economics of war, then the question of ambition. Okay, and it has also allowed us to go deeper into the characters, you know, minds and mindsets. Okay, where we once upon a time thought that, you know, Antony is a noble friend, he's an honest friend, he's a model friend, he then turns out to be a man who is avaricious, who is greedy, okay, who is power hungry, and one who uses individuals for their own, for his own purposes. Like how he uses Lepidus, like how callously he just orders the death of, you know, a lot of people whom he finds not, you know, good for the cause. Understand? And, you know, the way he treats Lepidus itself is a great indication. Understand? So this is what we understand. Then we understand the rise of Octavius Caesar. We realize that, you know, his time is coming. It is just at hand. He is just biding his time. Understand? So all of these things become very apparent. Then on the other side of the faction, we find the deteriorating relationships between Brutus and Cassius. And the only reason probably that, you know, they have reunited is the fact that they know that they are in danger of being defeated by the armies of Octavius and Antonius. Understand? So, and of course, it is there that we discuss the ethics of war. So, in its totality, you realize that apart from it being a kind of a rendition of the life and times of people like Julius Caesar and Brutus and Mark Antony and Octavius and so on, you know, the stories which have been heavily borrowed from Plutarch's Lives, okay, you realize that the play is also a wonderful exposition or an inquiry into the nature, into human nature, understand? And the kind of nuances that shape human nature. Nobody here is a clear villain or a clear hero. Everybody has the shades of hero and villain combined in them. And this actually, you know, these shades of gray is what is truest to human nature. You can never find somebody who is an out and out villain. You will never find somebody who is an out and out nice person. There will always be an element of the good and the bad. You know, here, what Shakespeare has put forward are, you know, towering heroes. They are great heroic figures, but they are also vulnerable. They have their own levels of tragic flaws. And if you scratch the surface, they are just as, you know, insecure. They are just as colluding. They are just as conspiring, just as prone to gossip, misunderstanding, anger, and ego as any other ordinary human being. What sets them apart is the magnitude of the effect of their actions. Understand? The magnitude of the effect of their actions. When ordinary human beings are jealous, when they are, conspiring, you know, that does not lead to the entire breakdown of an entire nation, a republic that is at civil war with each other, the death of people that, you know, you once considered friends. It does not throw the entire nation into chaos. Understand? It maximum might happen between this side of the wall and that side of the wall, and that is it, it is over. But here, this entire catastrophe, this cataclysmic sequence of events are, is what sets these people aside. Okay, apart, I'm sorry. Okay? Yeah. So, is there anything that you would like to ask with regard to the play in its totality, having seen this entire thing, you know? Because then we can move on to the questions, that's why. Anybody?
I think we can move on to the questions.
Okay. So you people were asking me to speak about inflexibility and compromise in Julius Caesar. Now, in the previous classes, we did speak about, how Caesar represents inflexibility. Okay, how, he refuses to go back on his decisions because that would seem like he was vacillating or he was indecisive. Okay, so Caesar's entire life is focused upon seeming the ideal ruler, seeming the best administrator possible. And for that, he imagined that, not backtracking on his decisions would project an iron will. And this has much to do with, the kind of society that Rome was, where, physical strength, physical appearances, all of these contributed towards the public image of a person and determining his power. Understand? Yeah. Now, compromise, on the other hand, is something of, a quality that comes about in the conversation between Brutus and his wife Portia. Understand? Where, Brutus's wife persuades him to confide in him, to tell him, confide in her, to tell her what the matter is. And, he kind of decides to do that. He gives in to that demand. Understand? So at the same time, you have to contrast that with the way that, Caesar treats Calpurnia. Okay. Where he first, irritatedly agrees to, stay back. But then, when he finds a version that he likes better, that stokes his ego, he goes with that completely disregarding her. And then the next instance of compromise that we see in the play comes towards the end in these acts, in the conversation between Cassius and Brutus. Okay, they talk about the economics and how, Cassius advises Brutus that at times like this, there are some things that you have to ignore, that you have to pretend like you did not see. Understand? He says that is very, very crucial. So he's trying to teach Brutus the art of war and the art of compromise. But Brutus is so hinged or latched onto his idea of honor that he too believes that making a compromise does not show wisdom. He feels that that shows weakness. Okay, so in this play, what you realize is inflexibility is seen as a sign of strength and compromise is seen as a sign of weakness. And weakness is not something that Roman society would easily admit to. It's only towards the end, just before Cassius dies, that we even realize that, he has a vision problem. Understand? So does that answer your inflexibility and compromise in Julius Caesar? You can supplement it with instances from the play. Okay? Now, here I will need a verbal answer.
Yes, ma'am.
Do you find it Yeah, it's clear. Okay. Now, next, fate in Julius Caesar. As you know, fate, destiny, all of these have been often evoked in the play. Okay. And, you know, many of these events that the men initiate are later on left to fate. See, because, you know, when Brutus says, now fates will decide whether we will be known as traitors or whether we'll be hailed as heroes. But fate is not what made them do these things. These, you know, actions were their own responsibility. But at one point, you know, where, you know, things cannot be decided or the future cannot be determined, they are prone to leave it to fate. So, you know, fate has its own role in this particular play on account of the fact that, you know, things that cannot be decided, that cannot, you know, be estimated, are left to fate. Understand? And in that aspect, these noble men of Rome are no different from commoners. Okay, now play of politics and history in Julius Caesar. As I told you, you know, lots of the narrative, much of the storyline, etc., has been taken from Plutarch's lives. Then it has also been taken from the life and times of Brutus, you know, number of books like that, all of which have been authored by Plutarch and, you know, other Roman historians of the time. And what Shakespeare has done is that, you know, he has kind of let's say manipulated the time frame. See, here you feel that, you know, Caesar was killed today, then next day they had the funeral, on the same day they had the funeral, you know, like that, and then they went off to battle. It is not like that. Okay, Caesar was killed, and, you know, this entire process of Mark Antony inciting the crowds and the crowds breaking into civil war and rioting, etc., that happened over the period of 6 weeks. Understand? Similarly, these battles and the forming of the second triumvirate. The second triumvirate was formed 1.5 years after the death of Caesar. Understand? And these battles took a considerable amount of time to come to their culmination. There were lots of events and incidents in the interim, which, for the sake of, I suppose, dramatic convenience, Shakespeare has omitted. Understand? So, you know, he has used history. Shakespeare has used history, as he has used history in his other plays, as a platform upon which to, you know, construct his characters, you know, and their unique situation in life. Okay, so, you know, he did not give as much importance to the veracity or the truth of his narratives, okay, truth of his, the historical parts of his narrative, as he did to his understanding of the characters. Okay, so his main concern was to flesh out the characters, to bring about a sense of, you know, dramatic catharsis, to effectively convey to the audience these people and, you know, what set them apart, what made them unique. Understand? So he used history as an instrument. Okay, he used history as a device rather than as you know, for the sake of its authenticity. That is why. So this is why you find, you know, mild anachronisms. You find these rapid, you know, events that occur one after the other. All of these is found. Okay. And as far as politics is concerned, again, see, he has not really clarified the various relationships between these characters. He has just mentioned them in passing because, again, he believes them to be incidental to the narration. You know, he does not believe that they are central to the narration because he does not really, I suppose, concentrate on the fact that, you know, Octavius is Caesar's great grand nephew, okay, his heir. He does not, you know, stress on the fact that this man, Cassius, and Brutus are, you know, brothers-in-law, okay. Or that it could be a possibility that, you know, Caesar is, what's his name, Brutus's father. Okay, so none of these things are stressed upon because they are not important as far as his, you know, dramatic process is concerned. That's the thing. So, you know, what we see is actually a number of characters who are interestingly placed against each other and how their interactions work and what it leads to. That is what is concentrated upon. Okay. And also how these characters appear. What is, you know, the what is their motive? Okay. And what is their purpose? That is what Shakespeare finds extremely interesting. And so, you know, and but there's a lot that is revealed in terms of what politics is, what administration is, what ambition stands for. And he raises this very important question: is politics, can politics ever be separated from personal ambition? That's a very important question that Shakespeare raises. Can politics be separated from personal ambition? Our experience of the world, our examination of history shows that that is not possible. Okay, it is not possible to separate politics from personal ambition, because if that were possible, then people would not attach these titles to themselves. They would not be calling themselves so-and-so the prime minister, so-and-so the president, the supreme commander of the armed forces. See? Those words, those designations carry a certain amount of power, and that power is very personal. Understand? So that is why, you know, the triumvirate. So rather than being part of three people, a group of three people, Caesar wanted to be distinct. Okay. But he wanted to be distinct at the same time, work for the Republic of Rome. He wanted to work for the glory of Rome. He wanted to, you know, actually serve the Romans. But he wanted that level of distinction. Understand? So this is a play that, you know, very deeply goes into the minds of the politicians. Okay. It also discusses what makes a politician, and whether a politician can be honest, whether, you know, he can separate his job from his ambitions. Okay. Is there anything else you would like to add to this about politics and history, or anything that you would like me to discuss? No?
No, ma'am. I think we can move on.
Okay. How do the acting and rhetoric affect the events of the play? Did this question come in your exam? I mean, in one of the papers?
Or are no, you just... ma'am. Rima, it's Suma's question.
Ah, Rima, what do you mean by acting and rhetoric affect the events of the play?
I saw this question in a website. I couldn't understand it completely.
I think what they're trying to ask you is, you know, if this play was staged and if you were watching it, how would it affect you as the audience? Possibly that, and that I think we have discussed in terms of the Aristotelian, point of view, right? Where it could lead to catharsis, it could lead to that purging of emotions, that is one thing. Then also the rhetoric in the play, you know, the conversations, the way that these characters, Rima, please mute your mic. The way that, you know, these characters spoke about themselves and their philosophies of life, that would color the audience perception of these characters. Okay, because you're not looking at the actor, you're looking at the character that is being played by the actor. Understand? So when, you know, cast and what has in mind and what he wishes to accomplish by using Brutus as an instrument, what happens here is that, you know, it colors your perception. So in a way, I would say that, you know, Shakespeare has created such powerful characters for his actors that it is impossible to just treat this play as entertainment. Okay, you will distinctly be looking for real life parallels from your own life. You'll be like, oh, this person reminds me of Cassius. This person reminds me of Casca. That person reminds me of Brutus. Understand? Or you might find these characters in yourself. So it is impossible to treat this play as an avenue for entertainment. In fact, it could very well become the parallel for life. Okay, is that satisfactory, Rima?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Now, supernatural elements and its significance in Julius Caesar. We have discussed all of that in the previous acts. And I also told you that Elizabethan society was one that was highly superstitious. It believed in the the ideas of, you know, omens, signs, and, you know, I also told you they believed in cosmology or the influence of the planets. Okay, all of these things were there. So therefore, you know, the spectacle also, the spectacle aspect of these, of this play might also have appealed, you know, to the audience. In the sense that, you know, all these grand descriptions of the meteorite shower, the comets darting across, the idea that, you know, lions were giving birth in the Capitol, there was a slave with his hand burning, but it was not burnt. All of these things, you know, when they are narrated, the story of the two eagles being replaced by the, you know, scavenger birds, all of this would have, you know, interested, or, you know, it would have kind of heightened the interest of the Elizabethans in this particular play. And also, you know, because the society itself was so superstitious, when Shakespeare mentions, you know, these, you know, omens and portents, what would happen is that, you know, it would be easier for the Elizabethans to understand or absorb what is happening. Understand. So, you know, they would not have to have too much of explanation. They would be immediately able to absorb the significance or the magnitude of the events that are unfolding or are yet to unfold. So, you know, when Gassius says that this is my birthday, and all of these days there were these two mighty eagles that were, you know, following our troops, but now they have been replaced by these carrion birds, ravens, crows, and kites. Immediately, the audience will also understand without much explanation that this is going to be a tough time for these people. Similarly, you know, when Caesar, when the messenger comes back to Caesar and tells him that, you know, the oracles don't want you to go anywhere because they sacrificed the beast and looked in its entrails and could not find the heart. How could that animal survive without a heart? Right? That is science speaking. But in terms of omens, this would have been something easily understood by the Elizabethans. Understand? So, you know, what he does is that he uses these supernatural elements as a dramatic device in order to, you know, kind of firmly establish in the minds of his audience the kind of gravity or the magnitude of the events that are about to unfold. And not only that, see this, the whole idea of, you know, what Calpurnia says, that, you know, when beggars die, there is no noise being made, but, you know, the entire nature comes out to announce the death of princes. Now, Elizabethan age was also one of those ages that believed in the divine right of kings to rule. Understand? So, obviously, you know, they will also be able to identify, because they are also, they were also a monarchy. So they would also be able to identify and, you know, kind of understand that, you know, Caesar was a kingly figure. So in that, in terms of symbolic value, in terms of dramatic and narrative value, these supernatural elements were very, very important. Because see, the ghost of Caesar, right? He was, he appeared only to Brutus. Cassius was equally wrong, but he did not appear to Cassius. Because Cassius, till the point of eagles, was an Epicurean. He did not believe in omens and signs and portents. Okay. But Brutus was not like that. So possibly it was his mind, his psyche, you know, projecting his guilt upon the ghost of Caesar. It could be that, right? So you can you know, put all these things together. And yes, the persuasion or winning of Brutus in Julius Caesar, I think that we had already spoken about, didn't we? At great length when we spoke about... that scene where I, you know, kind of had told you that these, what do you call it, you know, gradually by, you know, kind of giving verbal clues, by taking verbal clues from, what's his name, from Brutus, you know, this man Cassius gradually wins Brutus over. And, you know, the ways in which the word is built up, it is kind of, you know, narrated, it becomes very obvious. So that, do I need to go over that again? The persuasion or winning of Brutus?
No, ma'am, we already discussed that, so it's fine, I think.
And, you know, when you're doing that, you should also mention that, you know, you get a lot of insight into the character of Cassius.
Cassius. You know? Yes, ma'am.
So it is not just about the gullibility of Brutus, it is also the cunning as well as, you know, the manipulative ability of Cassius, that, you know, he tells Brutus exactly what he needs to hear. Okay, he tells Brutus exactly what he needs to hear. Okay, now what is meant by Senecan revenge tragedy? Yeah, see, Senecan revenge tragedy, Seneca was a Roman philosopher and he had written these plays. Okay, and they were rather, you know, they later on became the milestone of a certain kind of tragedy in Rome and later on in England as well as in France. Okay, but particularly in Elizabethan tragedy, tragic traditions. So, you know, in this, in Senecan tragedies, it is a revenge drama. You know, you have plays like Hieronymus, Mad Again, you know, a number of other plays that were written during the Elizabethan age. So, you know, there would be a chorus on stage. Okay. And this chorus had a very important role. They would be the ones who would be furthering the narrative, who would, you know, kind of sing the narratives and tell you the story that is about to happen. And the Senecan revenge tragedies were rather bloody. Okay, they were quite violent. They were characterized by violence. And they also, you know, had this very high standards of rhetoric. Okay, and very, let's say, grand speeches that were made by the characters. But in the end, and there would always be a ghost figure that would be thirsting for revenge. From that point of view, Julius Caesar is a Senecan tragedy. Then Hamlet is a Senecan revenge tragedy. Macbeth is a Senecan revenge tragedy. Okay, not so in the case of Othello. Not in the case of Othello. Okay, because these, all of these kind of, you know, follow that kind of a tradition. They are rather violent. The characters are given to grand outbursts. Okay, there is an element of revenge in them, understand, where the one who has been wronged and killed on account of either envy or a misunderstanding, who did not deserve to die, when an innocent person like that dies, or even if he is not innocent. Okay, see, in Seneca's place, there was no that kind of a moral. So when a person has been killed by unfair means, his ghost comes back thirsting for revenge. Okay, and this revenge is carried out through the actions of other human beings, okay? And, you know, the ghost deserves or demands satisfaction. The ghost demands satisfaction. And so, you know, if you notice in this play, all these characters, Cassius, then Brutus, etc., died with the name of Caesar on their lips, okay? And in fact, there are a number of plays that have followed this this particular, formula. Like I told you, Hieronymus, Mad Again. Then there is Gorboduc, the first ever English tragedy written by Sackville and Norton. That was also a Senecan revenge tragedy. So it appealed to the sensibilities of Elizabethans, you know, having that kind of bloody, you know, stage where a number of characters died by most violent means, a ghost that is out for revenge, and, you know, a cause, and that cause has to be avenged, and the ghost has to be finally put to rest, all of these things. So in that way, in you know, if you consider Julius Caesar, it is almost a perfect Senecan revenge tragedy, with the exception that there is no chorus. Okay?
Okay, ma'am.
Symbols in Julius Caesar. You know, the number three is a symbol. Then the daggers are symbols because all these, you know, people, be it Brutus, be it Cassius, all these people kept saying, you know, we will stab ourselves with this dagger if we are not found to be worthy. And finally, they all died. Sadly, you know, with those very swords that they had plunged into Caesar. Then, you know, you have, what else is a symbol? Any idea? I mean, let me hear from you.
Ma'am, the usage of clock was an anachronism, something like that.
The usage of clock is an anachronism. Anachronism is different from being a symbol, but I'm talking about symbols in specific right now. What else could be a symbol in this play?
Ma'am, use of honor.
Yes, honor. Honor is definitely a symbol here because at various times, the concept of honor is a symbol actually. At various times, the concept of honor, starts to take on different coloring and different complexions. Okay, so on one hand, in when this man Brutus was blameless, when he was free of any blemish, he was considered to be an extremely honorable man. But later on, right down to the last segment of the play where he talks about honor, it looks like he is mocking himself. Okay, he is living in a memory of his old self. So it seems like that. Okay, then the word honor, as it was used by Antony throughout his entire speech, in all these places, the word honor is a symbol. It is symbol and it is symbolic also. Any other symbols that you feel is there? Statues. Yeah, sorry. Vani.
Storm, a storm in which happened in Rome. It
Yes.
storm.
Acha, you mean to say the events that preceded the Ides of March, the
Yes.
cataclysmic events, the atmospheric
Yes, ma'am.
disturbance? Yeah, sure. Because that is also a symbol. It's a kind of sign of the troubled times that are coming, and also it shows, or it's a rather, it's symbolic of the gravity of events that are going to unfold. Understand? So that way, yes, that is a symbol. Then I was mentioning a symbol just now. What was that?
Statues.
Ah, yes. See the various statues that dotted Rome. Understand? So they were symbols of an age of glory. They were symbols of the various conquerors. Okay, and there was also the statue of Caesar, and you had Flavius and Marullus who had pulled down the decorations, and they were killed for that. But at the end, what happens is, Caesar dies at the foot of Pompey's statue. Understand? So these statues, while the human being is living, they are a symbol of power. But when the person dies, then those statues become pointless. They do not carry any kind of power or value. So, it shows the transitory nature of fame and power. Understand?
Also, ma'am, the killing of Cinna the poet, it is a mark of, it's a symbol of the violence of the crowd. How far the crowd can go with violence, is that
Yes,
right?
it could be a sign, or it could be an indication of mob mentality, right? That's also there.
Ma'am, this vultures and ravens, signs of
Yes, again,
defeat.
yeah, the signs of defeat, signs of tougher times, ominous, signs. So that is there. Now we spoke about the inflexibility of the in the play, right? We had talked at great length about that. The next question I have is, who is the single voice of reason in all the chaos in Julius Caesar?
Cassius?
No, Cassius was moved by jealousy. I have an answer, but let me see what you people come up with. I have two
Calpurnia
answers actually.
in some way?
Yes.
Calpurnia in some way?
Yes, that is one of my answers. Calpurnia in some way. Then anyone else or any other answer?
Soothsayer.
The soothsayer. Well, if Caesar had listened to him, then this wouldn't have happened. Blah, 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 play wouldn't have happened. But this play
Titinus.
had to happen. Yes, Vani?
Titinus.
Titinius. Why would you say Titinius?
He died for his friend.
That is very logical. I mean, you are a nice friend, Vani. Everybody, please make friends with her. But
Yes, ma'am, we are.
no, that's, see, when they say the voice of reason, it means who is the sensible human being? Understand? Who is not moved by emotion? Who balances, his thoughts? That is what we are looking for here.
Mark Antony.
Mark Antony. Why? No, I'm asking you why.
Ma'am, he is stable from the after the death of Caesar itself. We can see that what his motives are. He is unchanged till the last.
Yeah, he's in it for personal ambition and he does not hide it. Sure. Okay. So I suppose we could take Calpurnia, we could take Antony, and I would add Octavius. Octavius, you know, knows what is what and who is who. Understand? See, even when he when Antonius, you know, kind of denigrates Lepidus, he asks him, and yet, you know, you keep him as a friend and you make him do all kinds of things. Okay. And you know, he knows that, you know, he knows the kind of damage that Brutus has done. But at the end, you know, what he does is he gives him the full honor that a man like Brutus deserves. So all of that is there. So, you know, it could be that all these three people, there is no such thing as a single voice of reason, because each of these characters are reasonable in their own way. Understand? And that is a, you know, kind of should give you, and you have enough justification to answer that question. So, you know, if you say all these three people, you can always say that, you know, in a play that is so populated by polyphony, in a play that is so populated by polyphony, polyphony meaning, you know, number of different voices. Okay, different voices is called polyphony. That is so populated by polyphony, it is difficult to find one single voice of reason. Okay, so we will have to say that there are all of these people who seem to represent the voice of reason at different points of time in the play. Calpurnia, when she was trying to make a very level-headed decision to ask Caesar to stay back because, you know, even her instincts told her that this is some event that they have to be careful about. You have, you know, Mark Antony, who is a very reasonable man because when he did, I mean, you know, he seems to have a certain degree of intelligence because he did not push himself forward or exert himself, you know, till Caesar was alive, because he knew that he is secondary to Caesar. So that is a man who knows his place in the world that he lives in. Understand? So he does not really bother. But when Caesar is gone, he realizes the precariousness of his own situation, and also the fact that he has to take revenge, or he has to avenge his friend, because it was a gross injustice that had been carried out. But in this process, what also happens is that he does not see why he should not stand to gain from this act. That's a very practical way of going about it. That's exactly what Antony did. So in that way, he was the most practical of them all. He was the most level-headed of them all. Octavius, on the other hand, is the last or the late entrant into this play. And yet at the end, you see that, you know, he has established his leadership to such an extent that his is the last voice in the play. Okay. And he says that Brutus shall be kept in my tent, which means that in this triumvirate, you know, by the result of his heritage, okay, by the you know, the strength of his surname, he has established himself at the top of this triangle, this triumvirate. He has established himself at the very top. That is why he gives Brutus the honor of being placed in his tent. Understand? And that is a very subconscious, a very interesting way of conveying his structures of power. So that way, for one so young, that shows remarkable maturity and political acumen. Okay? Let me see. Somebody asked me, what is the meaning of the word quibble? Oh, well, quibble is an argument, you know, it's a very, let's say, nitpicky kind of, very inconsequential sort of argument, but it is an argument nonetheless. That is it. So that ends your doubts. Is there anything else?
No, ma'am.
All of you, sure.
Yes, ma'am. No.
Okay. So, is this play clear to you?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
yes, ma'am.
I'm going to stop.
Yes, ma'am.
One second.